Hello and welcome back. This is Fahad, and this week we will discuss industrial boilers, gas and gas trains. It's a very important subject because it will enable us to control the fuel, and there's a lot of code involved when it comes to gas industrial boilers. So we'd like to revisit the element of combustion. I would say we need fuel, air and ignition. Those three components are essential to having any kind of combustion or fire. What would be the easiest thing to control? Let's think about it. Air is all available in the control room, so air is all around us, so it's really hard to control. Ignition, it's a problem to control because once we ignite the fuel, it's really difficult to distinguish it. So the easiest thing to control is the fuel. And probably you have noticed that with a lot of fires, if you want the fire to go, like if you have a bonfire or so, usually you just stop putting fuel on it, it will just go out by itself. So fuel is the easiest way to control. And so is if you think about your car, again, you always control the gas, not the air, not the ignition. Okay. So what is a valve train? It's a train made out of valves, meaning one valve after another, and they go in line, in series, because they are safety and control elements. So it's the purpose for that is controlling the fuel going into the combustion chamber, regulate the fuel, the amount of fuel, and also act as a safety device to shut off the fuel whenever something goes out of bound. So most codes are written in regards of fuel valves, and again that can be both for oil and gas, but mostly gas. So what kind of valves do we have in the industry? I posted a video on Blackboard about the main types of valve, how they operate, what their function, and again we're talking about industrial boiler in this week. So they have the manual one where you can go and adjust and shut off, I don't know, by your hand, but again that's not very practical, and that will call for too many operators to be there to turn on or off valves. And we have automatics valves are like motorized, solenoid or diaphragm. They can be operated automatically remotely. In the past we used to control those valves using pneumatic system, meaning air, but now mostly there are electronics, or they are controlled by control boards. And lastly we have safety relief valves, which are self-operated based on the pressure at that point. So these are the main valves we will see in a big power plant or big commercial boiler. So manual operated valve, again, is still required to be there. They're usually open, but they are for safety reasons. If the automatic system failed, we have something to control manually. So even though we have automatic valves, we would like to have manually operated valves for the case of emergency and to control the operation when the system, the automatic system fails. Advantages of solenoid. That's one of the first types. Solenoid valve is very fast, it's very inexpensive, and it's very simple. So it's either on and off. We control a coil. If you remember from the past, we did that for oil. We have a coil. That coil is controlling a pin, and this pin is shutting on or off the fuel. So once we energize the coil, the pin will go up. When it's de-energized, it will drop, and it will stop the fuel. And if you notice, depending on the fuel pressure, it will be more important to control the pressure of this pin dropping in or the flow going through this valve. We want it to be a very small amount of fuel. So that's an automatic valve for solenoid. If we want to look at the solenoid when it's de-energized, if you notice again, remember when I said that we had to have a small amount of fuel going through to be controlled? This is the amount of fuel we need to be controlled. So it's really easy to put a pin and energize a pin and shut off the fuel at a small orifice over here. And even though the inlet and output is very large, if you notice, we said the flow rate will always be the same. In here, and in here, and in here. So they're all equal. So what happens here, even though it's a very small orifice, the velocity will go really high. However, if the velocity is going really high, that means also the pressure is going really high. However, we are dropping the pin perpendicularly, so if we were able to counteract the flow in this little orifice area, we will shut off the fuel completely coming through the valve. So this is when it's out. When it's de-energized, it'll open up and the flow will go as intended. So they're very easy to operate. Big solenoid, this is my solenoid over here. And they used to be operated by either a coil, and in the past we used to use air pressure as the pneumatic system to open it or close. Diaphragm valve, it's a little bit different. It's kind of the same idea. Small orifice area for the flow to interact with the stem. However, we have a flexible diaphragm here, which will slow open, and also, but it is very fast closing. So this diaphragm is designed in a way that it will pop in and out. It will pop in to make it very fast closing, and it will open slowly. And it's really good to regulate gas. We want the gas to go out slowly. You don't want to come popping all at once. And when you want to close, you can shut it off completely because you don't want the gas to be seeping in there when it's not intended. Advantages, again, they're inexpensive, they're cheap, they're quiet operating, and they have a long life. So probably you have a diaphragm valve in your gas tank if you ever have a grill. If you had a grill or you had to grill outside, probably you have used, you've seen those little big valves on the cylinder. And those are diaphragm valves, and the reason it's large because diaphragm operation requires large diameter. Motorized valves are very flexible, and they have, as you've guessed from the name, they are valve with a motor on them. They can provide tight close off, and they also can control the flow rate, meaning they can be partially open, partially closed, and in different settings. It's also called a butterfly valve because of the wing. Looks like a butterfly in a way. So this is what I'm trying to look at here. So they do have different firing rate, and they control the flow rate and also the angle, because if we look at that control over here, some of them control the flow going in, and at what angle does it go? This is my angle here. So again, those are motorized, and if you see, there's a manual override over here to open it or close it, but you also can put a motor that will control your flow, and it will also tell you the position of that valve. So another piece of information that you can use with motorized valve, remember when we did the large rotor amperage and the full rate amperage or full operation amperage? So when the motor closes completely, the amperage of the motor will increase, and we can read that amperage to know that the valve is completely open or completely closed. So this is one of the scenarios where they can control the flow, whether it's complete or no. Or we can do half by timing it. There's a timer including how many turns does it take to turn that valve, half, quarter, third. So valve trains, here are some of the nomenclature for valve trains. Again, this is something you will need to know if you work in a power plant, but these are some of the general ones. So MSOV is a manual shutoff valve, safety shutoff valve, SSOVs. We use a lot of acronym in here. PRV is a pressure regulating valve, as it sounds close to the PSV, which is pressure safety valve that opens automatically. So I put, there is a practice for all those acronyms just to get an idea of how you can kind of like guesstimate what is the acronym. There's a big list of it, and again, you shouldn't worry too much about it, because usually every industry have their own nomenclature. They're not universal, and we like to go with the acronyms or abbreviation. So abbreviation is when you have to spell it out, like PRV, and acronym is when it can be pronounced, I have no example for something again. Like stick, for example, that's an acronym because we can pronounce it as a one word point. So the five sequence of operation, and we had six before, but these are the main one: pre-purge, pilot flame, main flame, running period, and post-purge. And sometimes we have a sixth operation here, which is proving the pilot flame, but these are the five main ones, sequence of operation. If you have to add one, you can do proving of the pilot. So here's an example of a pilot of a train of valves. You notice here that this is my main fuel valve, and this is my pilot valve. So again, this is for mass gas train, for oil, for gas burners, between 400,000 and 100,000 BTUs. So this is the train required for the pilot, safety shutoff valve, pressure regulating valve, and a manual shutoff valve. So manual is very important to have, even though the whole thing is automatic. So we have a manual here, manual, safety shutoff valve. And so we have two now for doubles in case one of them failed, and we want one before and after. Also, they're very good for replacement and gauging those pressure valves. So you can isolate, take out those valve, and shut them off. This is the main fuel line coming in. Another manual shutoff valve here for the incoming gas before we even go to the pilot and the main fuel. So if you notice, the fuel, we are using the same fuel now for both main and pilot. From a million to 1.5 million, again, you can see more configuration of those valves. They are the same, we just have to have more of them. And this time we're adding more pressure controls. So we have gauge pressure after the regulating valve, two safety shutoff valve valved up each other, leak test, another diaphragm, manual, and the manual in the main line. So that's between a million and a million. From 2.5 million to 5 million BTUs, that's really large. We have, again, similar setup, but we, what is the difference? Look. So we have two shutoff valves with seals, monitoring. We have a firing rate control. That's the additional here, additional requirement. And again, these are the codes. These are the minimum amount of valves you need to have. You can have more, but these are the bare minimum. So when they come and inspect your line, probably you will look for these connections. Well, what is this in here? This is a line support, for weight support, so the line will not be bent. So this is for support. And this is also support here, could be the incoming line as well. And we have two pressure gauges. So if you have to answer the question, I will put that in the homework. What is, how those gas train are rated? They are based on the codes, and they're also based on the BTU per hours for the symbols and notation. They vary from one industry to another. They're not always the same. Always check the legends and check the code for that plant, because it could be different, and every boiler maker, they have their own. So for general terminology, controllers, it starts and stops the burner. So basically it's the main controller, whether it's Honeywell, FireEye, any other company, the controller monitor the operation of the boiler. Primary or programming controllers, they supervise the burner operation. Limits, we have limits before, we talked about them, high and low pressure, be it for the gas or for the steam that we are producing. Pre-purge is the time that the lower motor has to be on before we turn on the pilot. Ignition trial, it's the time we give to try to prove fire, otherwise the burner will go in safety. Intermittent pilot, that means it's on for the entire cycle. I know that this can be a little using, but intermittent mean constant. Post purge is the time that we allow the blower motor to keep going to purge the boiler of the entire gas contents. Firing rate control. So in large boilers we have firing rate control, especially if we have gas, and that controls the amount of gas that goes inside the boiler and consequently the amount of air that mixes up with that fuel. Flame safeguard is a trademark, and it's done by Honeywell, so they call their control system flame safeguard, and it monitors the sequence of operation, the presence of flame. It can check its own components, so it's a control system that does the control and monitoring of the flame. We have two types of flame. That is something also will be beneficial to know. We have external flame and inherent flame. So external flame is the flame that is produced by ignition, so we have to introduce that flame into the boiler. Inherent flame is the flame that's caused by the residual heat inside the boiler. So we would like to eliminate the inherent heat. We don't want the the gas, and that's why we do pre-purging and post-purging. We want to cool down the boiler, so when we dump oil into it or gas, it will not ignite right away. The difference between primary control and programming control: timing capabilities, sequence of operation, flexibility, and we can also have additional functions as alarm or pre-check or adding more controls to it. I say failure and flame detection when it's a term that's called for, it looks like the flame is on, but it's not. So that's called unsafe failure. If you ever heard of that term, it means we have an unsafe failure of flame detection. That means it will show that there's flame, but there's no. I posted again in Blackboard the Cleaver Brooks, which is a big company in boiler industry, and their terminology for most boilers. Please let me know if you have any questions and watch the other video about types of valves in industrial and commercial boiler. Thank you.